Hello, everyone. And how are all of you doing? We are back. We are definitely back for another episode of Rob's Real and Ridiculous Podcast. It is episode number 39. Number 39, Man Cave Studios, Valley of the Sun. How are all of you doing? I hope you've had a good week. I hope you're doing well. And I hope you all got out to vote. Big election on the line, as we all know, this year. I don't get into politics, but I hope everybody got out to vote. And I hope that we see a lot of good change in 2021. But today, I'm going to get right into it. We finally have our guest here. He is in the green room, in the Zoom room, green room. We're going to bring in Cleveland Hughes right now. All right, Cleveland, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, we're finally connected. We had a little bit of a time change, too, with all the changes back and forth. I think you guys are an hour difference from us right now out there in Evanston. So, yes, good to join the show. Hey, just you've got a great story. I shared with my listeners last week. I watched your documentary on YouTube, the 23-minute, and I'm going to get that shirt out to all my listeners after we talk this week. But before we get into the good stuff, what I consider to be really good stuff and what you're doing, tell me just a little bit about your background, where you're from, just a little bit of the growing up type stuff.
So I grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area.
Okay.
A little city, Richmond, California. I don't know. It's not a popular city, but yeah. There's one movie about the city. It's the movie called Coach Carter. Have you ever heard of Coach Carter?
If
you saw that movie, that's the city I'm from.
Yeah, that's for some time ago, actually. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I'm from California. What else is there about me?
What brought you to Chicago or the Evanston, the Illinois area? Yeah.
I came here with a lady.
It's always a good reason. That's all right. It's always a good reason. Yeah, I've taken a few trips. It's probably one of my favorite cities. I've been there a few times on business.
Yeah.
Used to travel into Chicago, a little bit into Lombard, and had some good meals and some good times on Rush Street back in the day. So yeah, and it's a good sports town too. Right?
Sports are on fire here. It's so much fun.
I'm from Boston originally. I live out here in Arizona now, but when you look at the Chicagos, the Bostons, the New Yorks, and a bunch of just crazy sports fanatics. So that's what I loved about that city, right?
Yes, it's
good
really
stuff.
Great.
It's all about sports. Yeah. All right, so let's get into your business. Let's talk a little bit about your business and what you're doing with Healing Mitts. And there's a great story to share there. So if you just tell me how that all got started. I know you started out as a boxer. So if you want to talk a little bit about that and just kind of lead me into, what led you into then, really helping others through boxing.
Yeah, it happened by mistake. I just kind of stumbled into it. But basically what happened is after high school, I didn't really know what I was going to do with myself. And, after high school, it's supposed to be an exciting time. The world is your oyster, as people say, right?
Yep.
And for me, it didn't feel like that. It actually felt like a really scary place to be because I had no idea what it was that I was going to do. Some people have an idea, they have a uncle or, a cousin, a brother, a sister that does something. And it's something that they're interested in. And that they go to school and they explore more. But I didn't have that. And I actually, because I didn't have that, I worked like a part-time job. I worked for this company. Everyone knows this company, Starbucks.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm familiar with that. My girls love Starbucks. I think they get stock in it.
But, I was working at Starbucks, and I was really I really felt hopeless. And I kind of fell into a depression. Mm-hmm. I did not feel good. I felt like my life was purposeless. Serving Frappuccinos wasn't fun for me.
Wasn't for you.
It wasn't for me. So I knew something was wrong because all I would do was go to work and stay in my room and play video games. I knew something was wrong. So I actually started going to therapy. I took my little part-time paychecks. I paid a therapist. And I basically went there and said, I want to feel better.
Yeah, good for you there.
And, you know, what ended up happening is that, you know, I expressed that, you know, I wanted to be a professional athlete. You know, it's kind of like a lot of young men's dream to be,
I did the same. I wanted to grow up. I played hockey my whole life. My dream was to be an NHL, of course.
But the thing was, is I was kind of too small. I played football and basketball. I was too small. I'm a good athlete, but I'm not the athletes like, you know, Allen Iverson and, you know, Russell Wilson, those guys that are small, but for some strange reason, they just have the sauce, you know, they just make it happen.
They got blessed.
I didn't have that.
Yeah. Yep.
I didn't have that. And so, you know, my therapist was like, well, you know, you don't really have to make that excuse because there's a sport out there that there's parameters and there's weight classes. And I was like, wait, tell me more about this. And obviously I knew about boxing, you know, before, you know, I grew up watching boxing and things like that. And there was a little boxing gym very close to where I grew up. My parents would never let me go there because, you know, I'd get hurt, you know.
Of course. They worried about you.
they cared about me.
Yeah.
And so he was like, you know, maybe you should try boxing. And I was like, man, like I could be in a sport where I'm the same size as the other athlete. There's no size advantage kind of thing. Okay, cool. Why not?
Yeah.
Let's try this thing out. And, so I started going to a boxing gym and I got way more than I thought I was getting because it became very clear to me early on that boxing was a mental game.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And the mental game is you versus you.
Yep.
That was the thing that was, it was kind of mind blowing to me.
Mm-hmm.
And through the sport, I changed. I became a whole new person, more confidence, direction. I started thinking like a boxer in all aspects of life. And not in a way that people would think, you know, like I'm starting fist fights everywhere I go.
Right.
No, this is not what I'm doing.
Yeah, you started feeling good about yourself. Yeah.
I feel great about myself. Yeah. I felt confident. And I started assessing what was happening in my life and how that affected me internally.
Right.
The same way that when I was in the boxing ring, it wasn't what the other guy was doing. It was what the other guy was doing, how that affected me and how I needed to be in control inside of my own body to be in control, to make the appropriate responses to survive in the room.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. No, you know, and watching your video, I know you talk a lot about focus, right? And so you think taking that focus kind of helped with that, I don't know, that mental engagement of like taking your mind out of that area you were at before that you just wanted to get out of?
Yes. I mean, a big part of, you know, I'm glad you watched the film. Thank you for watching it.
Of course. I really enjoyed it. Yeah.
But the thing is what ended up happening is like the things that the therapist was telling me to do were the things that I was doing at the boxing gym.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's these things like mental rehearsal, right? When you're dealing with something like anxiety and depression, you have to have a game plan. Mm-hmm. You need to know what you're going to do in order to get yourself up and change your brain chemistry, you know, as you need a game plan for most things in your life.
Yep.
And that's where I started to gain control. You know, I just really started to all these different things. They just translated. I was doing them so often in the gym that I was doing them all the time.
Yeah.
You know, and that was one of the major things that made the huge difference is just the perspective shift, the self-awareness, you know, the introspection, all the things that came about when it came to getting better at boxing. It all came down to being better at controlling your emotions, training better, training smarter, you know, and having the appropriate responses and under the certain circumstances.
Yeah. And, you know, you're obviously, I know you're a young guy, you're a hell of a lot younger than me, but, you know, and I bring that up for a reason. One, I mean, kudos to you for having the courage to go seek help. Right. And you know this more than anybody else, you know, especially with what you're doing now and helping people. I know you'll get into that, is the fact that most people won't do that. Right. Or they feel like I feel afraid, or I feel embarrassed, or I would never want anybody to know that I reached out to somebody for help. So it takes a lot to do that.
Yeah, totally. And I never once, and I was talking, I was on another podcast earlier, and I was talking to someone about that, and I never really was afraid what anybody was going to think.
Good for you. Yep.
I was afraid of where my life was going to go if I didn't seek help.
Mm-hmm.
That's what scared me.
Yeah.
Not living a full life. Was a motivating factor for me.
Yeah, that's awesome. I mean, to have that mindset to go through it. So now you started out, I think you started out in, was it 2014 you were doing the boxing?
I started in 2009. 2014 is when things changed for me.
Okay, I got you. Yeah. And, you know, and just going back to 2009 to get it, so you boxed, right? You did some competitive fighting?
Yeah.
And did you have a style that you mirrored? I mean, I know we're going to talk about, you know, about some boxers that I asked, you know, who do you like to follow? But did you have a style that you, you know, when you were starting out, we all looked up to somebody back in my day, you know, some of the great hockey players of all time. I'm like, I want to emulate, I want to be this person. But how about yourself?
The idol of the times in boxing, Floyd Mayweather.
Right.
We all wanted to be Floyd Mayweather.
Right.
I mean,
yeah.
And even now that Floyd Mayweather's retired, everybody still wants to be Floyd Mayweather.
He still has the goose egg, right? He still has the zero.
He's got this mantra, you know, like live your life undefeated, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, man. It's exactly. Yeah. Definitely. I wanted to be Floyd. Now, was I good? And did I have the style? No, absolutely not.
Yeah.
Not even close.
Yeah.
That's who I wanted to be like.
Yeah.
But, you know, I kind of had my own style.
Yeah. Yeah. And so you did that for about 5 years then, it sounds like.
Well, I did it for 5 years. I took 6 months off and then I went back to it again.
Yeah.
So, I've been doing it basically
all day,
every day for the last.
Yeah. A best, better part of your life, right? A better part of your life, which is, that's awesome.
Better part of my life.
Yeah.
I've been doing this.
But now you decided to transition out of the fight game for yourself, right?
Yeah.
And put that into this business that you now have.
Yeah, I actually made that transition very early on.
Okay.
You know, when I was training for competitions, I found the desire to help other people get the same benefits that I was getting. That was the motivating factor for me.
Cool.
I've always wanted to help people. I never fought for me. I fought for other people, you know?
Gotcha. And so, so you got the idea, right? Came up with the name, obviously, Healing Mitts, which I love the name. And so what did you do? How did you start acquiring, you know, your clientele?
You know,
or did it just come to you because you were already, you know, out there and people were familiar with you?
Well, I mean, in Chicago, I mean, because this Healing Mitts thing, like I've always been a trainer. But when I came to Chicago, I specialized in just boxing training.
Okay.
And I worked at the big, you know, the title boxings and, mm-hmm. you know, like the different kind of boxing clubs. And that's how I got started just,
sure.
you know, working at gyms and, you know, just helping people and just being the best I could be. I mean, that's basically how I got started, just working at the gym.
All right. So you have all different types. I've watched, I mean, you partnered with, you've got some of, I was watching, obviously, Laura, Lupita. They seem like they're in the industry as well, right? So they are people that you've worked with, and have you partnered with them at all, or are they just share a little bit about them, because they had some great things to say about, you know, what you're doing.
Well, yeah. So I understand. And so the thing that happens in the fitness industry is that people have a scope of practice, basically. You're a personal trainer. And when I decided that I wanted to help people in the realm of mental health,
yep,
I sought out professionals to partner with to make sure that I wasn't stretching my scope of practice too far.
Gotcha.
Now, so if anybody were to come to me that isn't at the step, right, that they need to be at in order for me to help them, then I would refer them to one of my either doctors or therapists, licensed social workers, depending on what it is that's bothering them.
Well, sure.
That they would go into the network of mental health care professionals that I've partnered with.
I gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Now, and you've got, I know you do some of the online coaching, right? Mm-hmm. So are you obviously you've got a lot that you're doing locally. Has it gone outside of the area? Like what's your scope right now? Are you getting people from other parts of the country?
Well, right now I'm mostly working with people
within the area.
Within the area and from California, like the people that I've
your network
connected with.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I definitely want to help as many people as I can.
Yeah. You want to broaden that and reach out. Well, look, everything's, especially now, right? Everything's online.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, we can't really do much.
from interviews to, you know, with my line of my day job, WebExes and everything else, everything's going down that road. And then you also have a DVD series as well.
Yes. Yes. And the DVD series is kind of, so my passion, I like working with people, but
yeah,
the Healing Mitt program wasn't designed just for me to coach my clients with. It's something I designed that I want to teach, that I'm teaching to other coaches and trainers that want to get into this field and help people, you know, with anxiety, depression.
Yep.
Mental health disabilities, any of those realms. So moving forward, and that's where the DVD series came from, is because I was creating instructionals for other coaches to add boxing into their training toolkits.
Yeah, I gotcha. Yeah, and I liked, obviously, you're two of the clients that you feature on the video was, Demetra and Desmond? Right.
Mm-hmm.
And she had some serious anxiety issues and other things as well, physical.
Mm-hmm.
How's she coming along?
Oh man, she's doing great.
Yeah.
You know, because I see her often, and
yeah,
she told me, you know, you gave me the, I don't know if she said the will or the motivation, but I helped her dance again, and she loves to dance.
Okay.
She's a professional. She's like a professional belly dancer.
Okay.
And when she was, you know, sick and going through her chronic pain, she found it very hard. And also with her anxiety, she found it very hard to find the motivation to dance, and boxing helped her dance again. And those are the kinds of stories that I want to create for people.
Yeah.
You know, I want to help people live better than they ever lived before.
Yeah.
You know?
How rewarding is that? I mean, that itself's a great story with her.
I'm addicted to it.
Yeah.
You know, I am always searching for greater meaning and a bigger purpose in helping people feel better, do better, be better.
Yeah.
In their whole lives, you know?
Yeah. You know, and I always tell people, I know somebody, people are always trying to find a purpose, right? Like you said earlier, like I wasn't sure what I really didn't want, what I wanted to do. Some people wake up and they know exactly what they want to do. Once you find what you want to do, it has to be something you're passionate about, right? And I feel like if it's something you're not that passionate about, you in a way you're kind of wasting a little bit of time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're not going to be that successful at it. So, And anytime, you know, obviously just, you know, just talking to you here for the first time, obviously I know you're very passionate about what you're doing and you know it's very rewarding, right? And so your return on investment is what you're doing to help people, which I think is fantastic. Yeah. I think it's fantastic. So if you don't mind, I do like your four principles. Yeah. So if you don't mind talking about those just a little bit, I really like
sure.
If you don't mind sharing that.
So the principles are the lessons that the masters teach in boxing. I created the principles because I was talking to my clients and I was digging for deeper meaning. Like, yeah. I wanted to change people's lives. And I found that all my clients were coming to me, not because they wanted to get in shape and not because they needed exercise. They came to me because they were struggling with something. Just like, you know, just like the people I featured in the film.
Yeah.
And I found that people were using this as therapy. And I was like, okay, well, what about boxing is actually therapeutic? And that's how I came up with those four principles.
Yeah.
Obviously they were translated from the masters that taught me.
Yeah.
But I made it to where everyone, those lessons and those principles would be available to everyone. So the first one is the art of relaxed intensity.
Yep.
And I used to have some of my coaches and trainers would say things to me like, relax.
Right.
And I didn't really understand what they meant, you know, yeah. But there's a certain amount of fluidity and relaxation and alertness that you need to perform in the sport of boxing. Like you would need to perform in most situations in life.
Right. Absolutely. Very applicable.
So I found these principles that were not just exercises in the gym. They were exercises that would translate. There were mental exercises that went along with the physical exercises of boxing.
Yeah.
Right. And you know, the second principle is the active concentration. And it's more so about using your concentration versus using your instincts. It's having an appropriate response versus having a random reaction. Mm-hmm. And that right there was like, oh man, there we go. There's another one. You know, yep. There's another one that applies directly to boxing and to life.
Yes.
Right. And then 100%. We moved on to champion's breath, right?
Yes.
Champion's breath, control your breath, control your fight, control your life.
Yeah.
Because what happens is when you get anxious in the ring, and this was kind of part of it, like, coaches, hey man, you got to relax. So, well, how do I relax? Take a deep breath, slow your breathing down, control it, you know, box breathe, all these different breathing techniques that we came up with. And we called it champion's breath, right?
Yeah.
And then the final principle was technical focus. And that was the part of basically putting it all together with boxing, correct form and technique. And if you were cycling through all of the things I'm asking you to do, all these mental exercises, right? I'm asking you to do along with this physical technical focus, right? It's not possible for you to think about anything else.
Right.
No way you can do what I'm asking you to do and think about anything that's stressing you out. You
right.
do all four of these things, you are in the moment.
Yeah, you're not multitasking in the head, that's for sure, right?
That,
you're
focusing. It can't happen.
No, right.
It just, it's not possible.
Yeah. No, that's so good. Yeah.
And that's what it came down to.
Yeah. You know, the breathing thing's so big. I haven't done meditation, I shouldn't say, right? But I hear a lot of people that do it and it's fantastic, right? A lot of it's the breathing, right? But like to your point, you know, I'm a former athlete. I played hockey. I was into bodybuilding. I did a little bit of powerlifting. And you can get yourself so amped up in a sporting event, right? You get so self-anxious that, shit, I could blow a lift, right? Or I could go
on
stage, right? You're just like, oh, God, you're frightened. And it just changes your whole mood, but even your physical ability to do what you want to do. And then you apply that to the everyday stress that we're going through now. The stress of your job, right? Sometimes I'll get an email and it's a fire drill. I got to get something done within 15, 20 minutes. And all right, Rob, breathe, Breathe. It's good. Or maybe it's something you can even take a deep breath and say, let's park it and save it for tomorrow so we can address the situation in a much better way, right? So that's kind of when I looked at some of those things. You know, the other thing too is I've been doing this. I'm 39 weeks into doing this podcast. I started it right when sports was shutting down in February, which is crazy. Yeah. So obviously I wanted to talk about some other things. It's heavy sports focus, heavy entertainment, or lighter on the entertainment, but I bring that in as well. But the one thing I've said through this whole pandemic, right, is stay mentally strong. Do something, right? I work out every day. You work out every day. If I don't work out in the morning, I'm one miserable SOB. Right? It's kind of like brushing your teeth. And I'm sure you're the same way. Whatever time of day that you work out, if I don't get that done, my wife doesn't want to be around me. My kids don't want to be around me because that's what I need for my mental. I don't care if it's something, you know, half the workout that I do. It's still better than not doing it at all. And my day is so much better. And what I've tried to tell people, because, you know, people are struggling out there. I've got people that, you know, work for me that, you know, in some instances, they're a single mom or a single dad, or they're just locked up at home and they're not getting out as much. Some people are. It's a little different out here in Arizona. It's a little more open. But it's like, you got to get out there and do something for yourself, right? Walk around the block. It doesn't have to be hitting the weights or hitting the bag or, you know, doing all that. But find something, right? And that mental focus helps keep you mentally strong. And I just think it helps build up that confidence and endurance you need for everyday life.
Yeah. I mean, and that simple act of kindness towards yourself, will change the way that you interact in the world.
Yeah.
It'll make you treat people better.
It just does.
And that's what we need. We really
need that right now, don't we?
We really need to treat each other. Man. We need to treat each other with kindness. We need to treat each other better. And all those people that are out there that are anxious and they're having all these stress and all that stuff, it's really, really hard to be a good person, you know, under that amount of stress.
Yeah.
So you have to lower your stress so you can be a better person.
Yeah. Yeah. And I as years go on, you know, I try to, as I get older, I become wiser, and I try to always look at everybody, and it's kind of like, I'm very friendly. I'm an extrovert. Sometimes you come across people, they look miserable. I will always tell people, you don't know what's going on in their life right now. Right. Sometimes I don't want to go out of my way for that person or this person. This other, you don't know what's going on in their life. Right. Mm-hmm. And so you can impact somebody by just kind of opening up a conversation, if you will. Right. And get things going and get the interaction going. And then the more and more you see them, I'm not just saying a passing stranger, but we see those too. Right. The grocery store here. They're like, I don't know what's going on in their life outside of this place that's making them this angry right now, standing in line. So those are good points to make. They really are.
Yeah. Just being empathetic.
Right. Empathetic. Yeah. Empathy. Yeah. Wow. Amazing stuff. So, how are things business-wise right now? Like, I'm in Phoenix. I know everything's different from state to state. Have you been open as a gym over there?
Yeah, we actually, the city of Chicago, right? Cause I'm in Evanston. I also work in Chicago.
Yep.
Right now, everything's, not everything. The restaurants just recently got closed back down.
Okay.
And so we might be looking at more shutdowns coming down the pipe sooner or later. But right now things are open. Business is good.
Yeah. And I hope it stays that way. I mean, we know it's out there, right? But I think if we can find a way to do it the right way and push through it. Mm-hmm. I also work for American Express as my day job. And in my line of work, we support small businesses. So it's all about small businesses. So the more we see people, the last thing you want to do is see people closing up out there. And we need to help, you know, and that's another reason, help way to get people through a lot of this too, with the whole mental thing, right? Because you got to have some sort of income. All right.
Yes.
Before I wrap this up, anything else you want to add? I want to talk a little bit about some boxing a little bit with you, just a little bit in terms of who you follow. I know you already mentioned Floyd. And then just a little bit about football, but anything else you want to add to your business? So healingmitts.org, right? Is your site, right?
Yeah, you can follow me at clevelandh.fitness on Instagram.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. I'll definitely get that out there for everyone. You know, I was talking to somebody I worked with a week ago, and I said, you know, like, what you're doing is also, like, I feel like it's very inspirational to people, like, in the office. You know, we'll bring in speakers to help people with mentally coping.
Yeah.
So just kind of getting that out there, I think, can benefit everyone and anyone. So I wanted to share that with you. So I think your message can be very powerful to a lot of people.
All right, I'm going to write down a little note about that.
Yeah.
Start speaking at companies. Got it.
Right? You'd be good at it, you know? You could do it. Yeah. Honestly, there's a good market for it. There's a good market. Like, you know, Joe Montana. Do you remember Joe, the great Joe Montana from the Niners right up in your Bay Area?
I'm from the San Francisco Bay Area.
Yeah.
49er fan. Yes.
So I back in my day when I grew up, the Patriots, my team now, which I'm doing very well, but they stunk. So I followed the Niners for many years. I love Joe Montana. I had no idea until, I don't know, I want to say it's been 10, 15 years now, that he was a public speaker. And he did some great motivational speaking out there and did a fantastic job. So I think the message, you know, you've got a lot of areas to go into if you wanted to. I just thought I'd throw that out there. I think you did a great job. Thank you. Yeah, of course. Absolutely. Okay. So we got Floyd. Did you end up seeing any of that fight with Devonta last weekend by any chance? And
I got to see the fight.
Yeah.
He's
good.
It was a good fight.
It was a good fight, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean,
six rounds before he went down, right? De La Cruz.
Yeah.
And he hit the canvas hard.
Yeah, it was a little bit. You know, I always get worried when I see somebody get knocked out like that. Like, oh,
we
no,
did
I
too.
I really hope that he's okay. You know, but he's okay, and that's really great. I mean, and I like you know, Devontae Davis's. I think that fight was really good for him because he appeared vulnerable because he got hit a lot, you know, I think that, you know, other people in the weight class are going to look at it and say, oh man, I could exploit that. And so I think it's going to be really good for Tank in his future going forward because more people are going to be willing to fight him because they saw some chinks in his armor. So I think that's
going
to be
chinks,
really cool.
But he can take punches too. It was a trip. That's all that was, right?
Yeah, exactly. You know,
that was a trip.
The dude's a monster, you know, at his weight class. And
that was
a great fight.
And he's a great story, too. You know, his upbringing in Baltimore and everything, right? It's good to see somebody like that get out there. And he's going to be a great champion.
I really respect him, too, though, because when he landed that uppercut, he had another punch there, and he didn't throw it.
You know what I mean? He could really
hurt the guy.
That's true.
And he saw it, and I seen him. He walked away, you know. And I was like, big respect for him as a fighter. And
He's a class act.
Yeah. So big respect to him on that.
And I know Floyd likes to yap for his brand, right? That's what made him. Muhammad Ali, and I love Ali, you know.
Yeah.
But the kid's different, right? He's a little bit more. Yeah. I like the way he handled himself. I like both fighters. You've got Tyson on there. I'm a big Mike Tyson fan. He's had a house out here for several years, too. But what do you think about that fight coming up the end of this month, Thanksgiving weekend, with Roy Jones? Do you think they're going to just play it out like it's an exhibition, or are they going to go? They both look good physically.
I mean, they look great. But, you know, these two men are in there, you know.
They're my age. Dude, you know, I'm 57. Like they're in their 50s. Yeah. They're my age.
You have two really great boxers going at it, way past their prime. I hope it's an exhibition.
Yeah.
Because I would hate to see either of these guys get hurt. I mean, these guys, like, I've idolized them. I've idolized these guys. Like,
same
Roy
here.
Roy Jones in his prime was just
amazing.
Incredible. And
dude,
same
amazing.
Thing with Mike Tyson.
I hope that
this is a gentleman's bout.
Yeah,
I'm sure they'll make it exciting for the fans, but at the same time, I would hate to see one of these guys.
Yeah, they'll hype it up. You know, I watched Roy he was on Joe Rogan's podcast a few weeks ago.
Yeah,
and he said that they did change it. He wanted 10 rounds. Obviously, he wants more rounds, right? because Tyson's the puncher and he's more the, you know, he's the boxer, right? So he to me, he's longer for wear. You know, Tyson finally got his weight down, but, you know, Tyson's not an endurance guy. He just wants to come in and get the job done in the first minute. But he said that they were going to do eight three-minute rounds, and they scaled it back to 2 minutes, which is an advantage for Tyson. But Roy said, what the hell? Because Joe said, why did you sign off for that? He goes, look, I'm just going to give the people what they want, and whatever happens, happens, and we'll go from there. So that could make it a little interesting, too.
They're going to fight.
Yeah, right? I think so. You know,
I can't imagine that these two guys won't, though. I mean, the warriors and the
are they true warriors? Yeah.
I hope that they're by the third round, they're both too tired to do any damage.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm definitely going to get the fight for sure. Okay. Real quick. Do you follow UFC at all?
You know, in the earlier years of the UFC, I used to, but the UFC became, it seemed like, a popularity contest.
Yeah.
And I kind of fell off of it.
Yeah. 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 I'm more boxing than UFC. I do like UFC. I do like what Dana's done in terms of, you know, the hardcore marketing and pushing through, you know, the pandemic and getting fights out there. Talk about a great businessman. He's amazing. He's amazing. Yeah. But I bring it up for a reason. Did you end up watching the McGregor Mayweather fight a couple years ago? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well,
what did you think of that from a boxing perspective from McGregor? I know it's two
that
years.
That was interesting.
Wasn't it?
It was. Yeah. I mean, yeah. You know, even though it was 2 years ago, I was just talking about it with someone today.
Yeah.
You know, like it was interesting. And, you know, Conor McGregor did a really good job.
Yeah, I thought so too. But you boxed.
Really good job.
I thought so too. I think he got the right people in there to train with, right?
Yeah.
Took it serious. Because
he did a good job.
Yeah.
It was awkward. And,
yeah.
You know, it took a second for Floyd to kind of find his shots. And, you know, he executed his game plan and it went well. But I think it was an exciting fight for the fans.
Yeah.
And both guys made a ton of money,
didn't they? Oh my word,
it was a win-win, you know.
Yeah.
For everybody was excited, entertained, and the fighters got out of there without getting hurt, and they made a ton of money. I think that was great. That was a great event for boxing,
and they hyped it up good too. You know, some of it got a little out of hand on stage, but but, you know, and behind the scenes, those guys they shook hands and had a cocktail and a cigar together afterwards, for sure.
Yeah. $100+ million each. Like,
yeah.
Yes.
They're good. Yeah.
They must be best friends now.
Yeah, most definitely. And when I heard with McGregor coming back, he was thinking of fighting Pacquiao. I'm not, let's just let that go now. You know, I like Manny Pacquiao. He's made his money. Manny Pacquiao's probably on the back end of his career now, too. Two other guys real quick. Lomachenko. I was really surprised at that fight 2 weeks ago. He didn't look that good to me against Lopez.
Yeah, the thing is, I think that
he had a shoulder injury too, right?
I didn't.
He ended up getting surgery the week after, and he didn't use that as an excuse. But he ended up getting surgery the following week.
Did he have another shoulder surgery?
Yeah, it was either shoulder or elbow the following week. Yeah.
Oh well.
Yeah.
That would explain.
Maybe, right? He didn't look right to me.
That would explain his lack of activity, and that was the thing that hurt him the most. And I think that Teofimo Lopez is a big, strong, snappy, fast fighter, and I think that was a lot for Lomachenko in the early rounds. You know, he felt the power, and he felt like he needed to respect Teofimo Lopez, because if he got wild, Teofimo Lopez could possibly knock him out.
Knock him out? The activity was high on one side and not on the other. I kept saying, this is the round he's going to pick it up. I like both fighters. I've been a big Lomachenko fan. It seems like he's been, you know, doing it for a little bit longer, which he has. But he just never got into that zone.
He never got into that zone. And but I think that the future is very bright for both fighters.
Yes.
I think that Lomachenko is getting, you know, he's getting up there in age a little bit.
A little bit.
I think he's got a few years and. Yeah, I think we'll get a lot of good, great fights out of these two guys in the near future, I hope.
Yeah. Yeah, boxing's making a good, I will say the word comeback from, like, when I grew up, it was Hagler, and you had Leonard, and you had Tommy Hearns, and, you know, there was some great fighters back in the day. and it seemed like it went through a little bit of a drought with boxing. We feel like, you know, I brought up UFC. I think not so much now, but I think going back 5, 6, 7 years, UFC was kind of, I feel like, dominating a little bit in terms of the sport that people were watching. So there's some, even the heavyweights, right? The heavyweights, is some, I mean, you got Tyson Fury out there. You got Deontay Wilder, you got Anthony Joshua. So, I mean, there's some good heavyweights out there now, too. You still got Canelo waiting to fight again. We like Canelo. My wife's Latino, so she's a big Canelo fan.
Oh, man. I really hope that whatever is going to go on with Canelo doesn't take years of his career. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Because we've seen this happen before with fighters and, you know, not being able to fight and the inactivity. I really hope that we get to see Canelo in the ring soon.
Seems a while, doesn't it?
Yeah, man, it doesn't. Yeah. You know, these kind of legal litigations. Like, please, just let the guy out of his contract. However much money he needs to forfeit or whatever, just like get him out of his contract and let him have his career. You know?
You know, that kind of went south, and I don't know how you feel about Oscar De La Hoya. I liked him as a boxer. I think he started, and this is just again my opinion, I think he just got a little too big-headed, you know, running his show and then trying to control what's going on with Dazen, right? The Zone Network is where Canelo and him got into litigation, and it kind of turned on. So I kind of feel like he kind of turned on his own guy in a sense. But again, that's just my opinion, you know. I mean, shit, just politics and everything, right? With all these fight promoters and everything else.
Yeah, and then when you – I can't remember how big the numbers of the on the contract were, but the numbers were huge.
Huge. Oh, no, they were big, yeah.
And if the promoter is the promoter and the networks are offering that amount of money, you can't imagine the kind of money that they're expecting to make on their return on their investment.
Right.
They want to make more than the fighter is going to make.
Yeah.
And that's the hard part about, you know, boxing is the politics. But. Yep. I mean, I don't have any bad feelings for Oscar De La Hoya because you know he's done a lot of great things for the sport. Now I hope that he learns from this experience.
Right, everybody makes mistakes, right?
Yeah, and
he was a great fighter too. Yeah.
Yeah, he was a great fighter. I love watching.
Yeah, me too.
He was great, and so hope that in the future we see less and less of these kinds of problems in the sport.
Shit, man, we all make mistakes, right? This is how you move forward. So, all right, before I wrap it up with you, you do watch some football, something outside of boxing. Who's your team?
San Francisco.
There you go.
Not that great this season.
No, so I told you I'm originally from Boston. I've been out here in Arizona for quite some time now. But, with Jimmy Garoppolo going to the Niners, and we had Jimmy, and it's – I don't know. It just seems like injury prone, right? And the Super Bowl to me, maybe a little bit of a mental setback for him. But again, when you come off an injury like he had the prior year, right? You're going to play tentative a little bit too. And then, so I don't know if he's a fit for the system there. I keep hearing all kinds of rumors that they might just cut bait because of that, drop the salary and then, maybe, Shanahan will go after like a Cousins or even a Matt Ryan.
He's wanted Kirk Cousins for a long time.
He's
wanted him for a long time. Yeah.
So at this point, I'll take Jimmy back. I love Cam. I hope Cam can turn it around. But, I can't complain in New England, right? Because we've been spoiled for a long time. So,
you had all those Super Bowls. I know. It's like. For me as a San Francisco fan, I was frustrated. It was like, I wish Tom Brady would just go ahead and retire.
Yeah. Like, well,
how many more Super Bowls do you want?
Well, I said that too. He was getting upset at the end. It's like, go out against the Rams, right? Go out in style. Yeah. But here's where I wanted him to go. Supposedly, this is kind of my little insider information as if I'm connected. Yeah. But I mean, in terms of, I follow the local sports in Boston very closely. And, with a lot of the local shows there, and supposedly the trade was going to be Brady to San Francisco.
Really?
Yeah, and that but Kraft put the kibosh on it. So, Belichick wants to be done with you before you get old, which Brady's not showing age right now. But so he's like, I got my future right here with Jimmy. Let me cut bait with Tom. That was after the Philly Super Bowl. They called it up, and then he was calling on Brady, and Kraft said, it's Jimmy or that's it, because Tom didn't want any competition. So yeah. Just, you know, a little behind the scenes BS, but you don't know how it all works out. But anyways, it ended up being Jimmy. But what I was hoping for with Tom leaving New England this past year, which I knew he was going to leave and go, I said, damn, his boyhood hero, Joe Montana, he's from the Bay Area, as you know.
Yeah.
I would love to have seen him with the Niners this year, too, you know?
That was – that, you know, that was that, the problem with that is the 49ers did not have any money.
No, no cap space.
We didn't have any money.
No,
we had no cap space.
I know.
If we could have signed him, we probably would have.
Yeah.
But we just didn't have any cap space.
Yeah.
And that's why you don't see very much difference to the San Francisco team this season. Because
no.
They just didn't have any money for free agents, really.
No, and you look, and you know this, you load up. The Rams did it 2 years ago, right? And now they're suffering for it. So we'll see what happens. It'll be an interesting rest of the season. Let's just hope it continues to go, right? And we don't have any stoppages. It seemed like they're working through the COVID thing and we get to the Super Bowl.
Who do you got for who do you think is going to be in the Super Bowl this year?
I think it's going to be Tampa Bay against the Chiefs.
Yeah, that's what you think?
Yeah, what about you?
I can't really – I don't know who's going to make it on the – AFC, I really don't. I it's kind of – that one's a toss-up. Like, it could be it could be like one of eight teams over there. But I think
– it could be, right, on AFC, right, to your point.
Yeah, so it could be eight different teams.
I'm not penciling in the Chiefs either. Right now, you know, they get the championship pedigree right now. So if I'm going to give somebody an edge, Steelers look really good, right?
Steelers look great.
Fantastic.
I would say maybe like if I just had to pick, I would probably say like Kansas City and like Seattle.
Yeah.
You know,
Seattle. I love Russell Wilson. It's amazing what he's done this year.
He's a stud, man.
MVP. MVP.
Yeah, he's a stud. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He should have won MVP maybe a couple other times too, but he's definitely, I think he's going to get it this season.
Oh, he's been shortchanged on the MVPs for sure, right?
Yeah, he's a great football player.
Yeah.
And I'm a San Francisco fan. You know what I mean? We hate the Seahawks. You know, like we hate them.
Yeah.
But I cannot knock the man. He is a great athlete.
And they play each other tomorrow night. But, you know, to your point, I'm the same way. Like a lot of people, you got this hatred. You know, we're always rivals with New York and Boston.
Yeah.
Hate the Yankees. Yeah. Well, I always loved Derek Jeter. I had mad respect for Derek Jeter. Me, I'm a Celtics fan. I love Kobe Bryant, you know? Great Kobe Bryant. Mad respect, right? How do you not?
Yeah.
I mean, that's just kind of – and that's – you know, maybe I'm a little bit different coming out of that city, but that's how I feel. If you're good, you're good, right? And and not to mention, he's a class act too, Russell Wilson. So,
yes.
Well, listen, pal, thanks for coming on. I'm glad we finally connected. I appreciate you joining, and I will definitely get your information out there.
All right, man. I really appreciate it.
May be in touch with you sometime down the road.
Oh, yeah. We can talk anytime. Just
all right.
Know.
You bet, pal. Enjoyed it. Take care, Cleveland. All right. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
All right. And so there was our interview with Cleveland. I hope you enjoyed it. I certainly did. Shared a lot of good information about, you know, his business. And it was fun just getting into some boxing and talking about the, you know, where boxing's at these days, and the number of fighters that he follows and likes is, you know, pretty much what a lot of us like right now with boxing. So thanks again to him for coming on the show. As I wrap up this week's show, stay safe, stay strong, stay mentally strong. As I always like to say it, we've got some good games coming up on Sunday of this week, Thursday as well. We've got the Packers, Niners. We've got Baltimore and the Colts. We've got Miami and Arizona. I can't even read my own writing anymore. This is what happens when you get old. Seattle versus Buffalo is one to look at. But the game of the week for me is going to be New Orleans and Tampa Bay Sunday night. Right now, Chris Godwin is out, but we'll see if he comes back for Sunday. But it will be the return of AB. And God, adding to that team that already looks pretty much deadly is going to be something to watch. Will he stay in check? Will he stay in line? My prediction is he will. For whatever the reason is for Brady takes a lot of heat in the Boston market for his friendship with AB and people saying they would never let him, you know, in their home because he is staying with Brady again. But whatever Brady sees in him, and hopefully the guy's reformed. I'm always pulling for somebody to turn it around. I know there's some nasty things that, you know, he's done through the years, but I believe in giving somebody an opportunity, and this, for me, would be it. So we'll see what AB does. Sunday Night Football, Saints at Bucks. It might be the revenge game, right? Because the Bucks hosted opening day against the Saints hosted the Bucks on opening day. So good slate of games. Be safe. Stay strong. We're going to get some cold weather here, believe it or not. We're transitioning from Halloween into the fall. Next week here in Arizona, it's going to be like high 50s, low 60s. So we're getting some holiday weather here. Next week's guest will be entertainer, podcaster, musical artist, Jody Kay. She'll be joining the show next week. Ashley Villa-Lucas will be joining the following week. She has just gotten her pro card in the world of professional bodybuilding. So we've got some good guests coming up. So you're not going to have to hear me babble on for the next couple of weeks. Be safe. Stay strong. We'll see you all next week. Here's a little bit of God's Plan with Drake. And they miss me. Yes, I see the things that they wishing on me. Hope I got some brothers that outlive me. They gon' tell the story that was different with me. God's plan, God's plan. I hold back sometimes, I won't. And with that, I am officially out. I finesse down Western Road. Stay safe, stay strong. Peace. God bless. Bad things, it's a lot of bad things that they wish and they wish and they wish and they wish and they wish on me. Bad things.